I don't usually start with the second reading, but I like the letter of James. I think I've said that before. I like it so much that sometimes when people come to reconciliation, I give it as a penance. It's a short book, 5 chapters, but 5 pages, no big thing. We don't normally have such distinctions. Someone dressed in fine garb and someone who smells and dressed shabbily. I guess that's because laundry detergent is cheap. I say that even as they reminded me to clean my alb last week and take the ring around the collar away. But there are a couple questions I'm going to ask you this morning. One that is related to this first reading from James, because it has to do with the weekend assemblies. Why are you sitting where you are? Is it the same place you always sit? Is it because you hear better in that spot? Is it because your parking place allows you to come in and sit that proximate? Is it because you know someone else and you know where they're sitting, so you're sitting over here? Hey, it happens in the best of assemblies. Are you not drawing distinctions? Is the question that I lay on you from the second reading. What distinctions do you make? Male, female, young, old? Why are you sitting where you're sitting? And I trained with a very good priest, and we walked a lot around the parish. You can't do that out here. It's a long walk. But he would say, he would go down a different street every time, even in the car, back to the parish house. I said, Tony, why are you doing that? He said, because I can take the shortest, I can take the quickest, I know the way to go that way, but this exposes me to another place. I see different things on this street than I did on this street. It's good for me to be exposed to many, many different places. So that's the first question, and you're going to ask yourself that next week when you come in here and take the same seat. And don't all use the excuse, we have children and we have to take them out because they make noise, because God likes noise. And some of them are grandparents and there's not even a grandchild with them. Oh, my grandchild, I asked one, my grandchild is coming. They're not here yet. The second thing I want to talk about is Isaiah. The messianic vision was of the Messiah to be a healer. The blind see. Those who can't hear can hear now. Those who can't walk can walk now. That was the vision, and Jesus was doing those things. He was doing them so well that in today's reading, he wasn't even in Israel. He was in Lebanon. He was in Syria. He was in the Greek cities. Why? Herod couldn't put his hands on him there. So often with Jesus, it's the faith disposition of those healed. Say the word, I'll be healed. Lord, you don't have to come into my house. I know. At that moment, his daughter was cured, or this happened, or that happened. We think of Mark, and we think of all these healings. But there's only about three or four more that are recorded after the seventh chapter. That's it. And today's interaction is very strange. Because Jesus can't communicate in words with this person. Why? Because they can't hear. He can't speak to him because the guy can't talk straight. He talks garbled. So how does he communicate with him? He touches him. He takes him aside. He doesn't embarrass him in front of the people. The people brought this guy to him. He takes him aside, and he sticks his fingers in his ears. Hey, you want to hear? You want to talk? He touches his tongue, trying to communicate with him. Is this what he wants? And all of a sudden, the guy can hear. All of a sudden, the guy talks straight. And then he says something. Be opened. Ephphatha. There are churches named that. Ephphatha. Maybe that's a good call letter for a congregation. Be opened. The second question, remember the first one? Why are you sitting where you're sitting? Second, only two things today. So make it easy on you. What does Jesus have to touch in you to be healed? My brain, God. Somebody very kindly asked me this morning, Father, what's that bump on your forehead? And I said, it's the same thing I tell the kids. It's my brain's coming out. Maybe it's our brains that need to be healed. Maybe it's our heart. I don't know. I'm not going to give you the answers. You know yourself. What brings you here? What are you seeking? To be fed from the scripture, from God's table, to be graced, to be strengthened, to go out there and take a different path maybe this week to work or home, to open your eyes, remove the cataracts. What do you need God to heal in you? You only answer for yourself. We all want to provide answers for the others, don't we? Why are you sitting where you're sitting, and what do you want God to touch in your life about you to be healed? Amen.